Hello and welcome to my channel, Medicine with Dr. Moran. Today's topic is associated with a longer lifespan and reduces your risk of getting over 40 diseases. I'm talking about the health benefits of exercise. There are massive benefits to exercise, some of which you may not know about. I'm going to talk about how much different types of people should exercise, then how to exercise to get the most out of it. There are timestamps for your convenience below. It's been known for centuries, in fact. The ancient physician Hippocrates stated in the 5th century BC, and I quote, "All parts of the body, if used in moderation and exercised in labors to which each is accustomed, become thereby healthy and well developed and age slowly. But if they're unused and left idle, they become liable to disease, defective in growth, and age quickly." Unfortunately, the lack of exercise presents a major health problem today. Most people know that exercise reduces your risk of heart disease, stroke, and diabetes, but what about some of the other conditions? This slide is taken from a recent review of the health benefits of exercise, and there is a link to the journal article in the description below. This is a slide of 40 conditions which you will see are all related with lowering of a risk if you exercise regularly. You may not know that exercise improves depression and anxiety as well as balance and reduces the chance of falls and bone fractures. There are many cancers that are reduced by regular physical exercise, including breast, colon, and uterine cancer. On the list was reduced cardiopulmonary fitness, or VO2 max. VO2 max is the maximal oxygen uptake that someone has, and it's a measure of your cardiorespiratory fitness. A study in 2010 reported that men who went from a very low number to a high number actually reduces their chance of death by about 50% over an 8-year time period. Conversely, men who went from having a high VO2 max to a lower VO2 max increased their mortality risk by about 50%. Now, with the advent of wrist-based activity trackers and cell phones, people can now know what their VO2 max is, and they can compare this to other people their age. Here's an example from the health app in an iPhone of the VO2 max. So this is something that's actually very accessible to people nowadays. Previously, formal exercise testing, which I do in my laboratory, would be one way of measuring this, but the ability for somebody to have a pretty good idea of their VO2 max without going to the lab and see how it's trending with time just by the data generated from their wrist-based activity tracker. This is very helpful. Lifelong aerobic exercise training will preserve your VO2 max as you get older. Now, how much exercise is ideal? Well, there are guidelines out there, and what I'm going to say is from the Physical Activity Guidelines for Americans. Your country may have their own guidelines, but I can tell you they will be similar as they're based on the same kind of research. Now, it's estimated that about 80% of American adults are not meeting the key guidelines for both aerobic and muscle strengthening activity. It's estimated that this lack of physical activity contributes to $117 billion in annual health costs and 10% of premature deaths. Here are the key guidelines for preschool-aged children, as well as older children and adolescents. It's so important to establish exercise as part of someone's life in childhood so that it carries over throughout their entire life. Now, on this slide, you can see the guidelines for adults. Many adults have sedentary jobs like mine, and so it's important when possible to move more through the day and sit less throughout the day if you can. It's recommended that there be moderate intensity exercise for 2.5 to 5 hours per week. Alternatively, high intensity exercise from 1 hour and 15 minutes up to 2 hours and 30 minutes a week would be an alternate option. Now, the activity should actually be spread throughout the week as opposed to a single session. Moderate intensity exercises and high or vigorous intensity activities are listed on this slide to give you an idea of what constitutes each thing. For moderate intensity, most people walk briskly as part of their exercise program, but there are numerous other forms of exercise, as you can see on the slide, and they would give very similar perceived exertion to brisk walking. High-intensity activities would include things like running or other vigorous activities, such as cycling. If you exercise more than 5 hours a week, there's no evidence of any increased health risk if you do more than that. People often ask me how quick they need to walk, and this is going to vary based on someone's age and their fitness, as well as the terrain and other factors. A good rule is that you should be able to talk in 3 or 4 word sentences in between breaths while doing the activity. This is known as the talk test. If you can talk in longer sentences like I am, you're not doing it quick enough. Or if you're not able to get out 3 words between breaths, then you're going too fast. I often tell people that when you're going up a significant hill, whether you're running, cycling, or walking, that your speed will need to slow a little bit, or you'll get too short of breath. Now, many of my patients do achieve these activity targets, but what they fail to do often is the muscle strengthening activities. It's recommended that adults should also do muscle strengthening activities of moderate or greater intensity that involve all major muscle groups twice a week. I often tell my patients that as you get older into your 70s and 80s, the people that are able to stay living in their own homes and not needing a retirement or nursing home bed, they're those that keep their muscle mass and fitness up. Unfortunately, as you probably know, muscle mass goes down as we age, and when it's significantly reduced, we call it sarcopenia, meaning small muscles. Trying to prevent this decline is very important. These are the guidelines for older adults as well as women during pregnancy and the postpartum period. Feel free to stop the video to read the slides if you need. It's important that you're starting a health program to discuss this with your doctor, particularly if you do have chronic conditions or symptoms. This is often a reason for referral to me for exercise testing. Now, it's important to always start slow when you go with an exercise program. So start low and go slow in terms of intensity and exercise length. A good rule of thumb is not to increase your exercise amount by more than 10% per week to prevent injuries, especially if you're doing higher intensity activities. You don't want to injure yourself. Older adults are less able to manage those increases in activity week to week. I always tell people to find activities that they enjoy when it comes to exercise, because those are the ones that you want to do over and over. Walking with friends or family is one of the easiest and most enjoyable things that anyone can do. I explain to my patients that chores count towards activity guidelines as well. Things such as pushing the lawnmower, bringing in wood, raking the yard, shoveling snow, they all count. When you're doing exercise, you also need to listen to your body. If you're getting short of breath, you need to slow down or even stop for a moment to catch your breath. If your muscles, of course, are really sore the next day, you should consider taking a rest day from your activity. If you do get exertional symptoms like chest pain, nausea, lightheadedness, or if there's a sudden drop in your exercise capacity and you can't do things you were doing before, you should speak to your doctor. Exercise can be done safely, even in people with heart disease or lung disease, and in fact, it's very beneficial for their health. People with heart or lung disease need special exercise prescriptions, and this is often due through a rehabilitation program. I'm the medical director for my community's cardiac rehab program. If you're outside with your activities, consider air quality. You can reduce the risks by exercising away from heavy traffic, especially during rush hour or at other times when pollution might be high. Make sure that no matter what activity you're doing, that you're doing it safely and you have the appropriate protective equipment if it's needed. So to summarize for adults, we like to see at least 2.5 hours of moderate intensity activity and muscle strengthening activity at least 2 days a week. So those two things combined. When you're doing your aerobic activities, whether they be moderate or high intensity, it's also important to warm up before you start and cool down at the end. When you start your activity, you should warm up by doing your activity at a slower speed or lower intensity, and when you're finished your activity, you cool down by doing the same activity again at a slower speed or lower intensity. I explain to my patients that it takes the body 5 or 10 minutes to make adjustments when you're going from being inactive too active. The heart rate has to go up and the arteries of the body need to start to deliver, to actually dilate, to deliver more blood and oxygen to the exercising muscles. It makes sense to slowly work up towards the speed or intensity over the span of 5 or 10 minutes. I often use a personal example when I talk to people about warming up. Now, for example, if I'm going out for a run for an hour, if I start at the speed that I want to do for a comfortable run at, I will often feel a little out of breath if I don't warm up. It makes sense to start off by walking for a couple of minutes, then jogging for a few minutes before getting my speed up to what I want for the remaining hour, and then it's comfortable for the remainder of the hour. Often people start too quickly without the warm-up and they feel short of breath. That, of course, discourages them. For muscle strengthening exercises twice a week, we're talking about doing things like resistance bands or weights to exercise the core and upper body muscles. You can also exercise your legs with the resistance and strength training. You can use your own body weight for resistance, such as push-ups, pull-ups, and planks. Typically, people do a set of 10 repetitions for each exercise, and a second or third set would be more effective if you're trying to build muscle. Improvements in muscle strength are progressive over time, so you need to slowly increase the amount of weight or the resistance that you're doing. Flexibility exercises are important as well. As people age, their flexibility tends to go down, and of course, stretching exercises will improve your flexibility. I recommended stretches after an activity, not before, when the muscles are warm. I hope I've given you some tips in regards to exercise and encourage you to meet the exercise targets to improve your cardiopulmonary fitness and your health. Thanks a lot for joining me today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. I'm Dr. Keith Moran, and remember, get healthy and stay healthy.